spise også. I denne uken så har det vært på gang en stor mønstring av middelalderkultur i P2. Altså kulturkanalen her i NRK. Og vi her i Hovedscenen har også lyst til å være med på denne middelaldersatsingen. Og sender nå et portrett på en meget spesiell kvinne som sto sentralt i middelalderen. Hildegard von Bingen. Hun var forfatter, hun skrev viktige og store teologiske og visionære verk. Hun ble kontaktet av paver, av biskoper, av konger. Så sentral var hennes tenkning. Og ikke minst så var hun også en stor komponist. Og hun regnes vel faktisk som den første komponisten vi kjenner en skikkelig biografi til. Så her, Hildegard von Bingen.
Love is at work within the circles of eternity, without reference to time, like heat within a fire.
She saw plants, winds, rivers, human beings, and the world as a symphony. She spoke back to the emperor whose protection she needed. She directly challenged the pope, even though a pope had recognized her as a prophet. Poet, medical writer, visionary theologian, and composer, she was recognized in her lifetime as one of the most important figures of her age. But for almost 800 years, she was nearly forgotten. Her works are available to us today because they were preserved through centuries of brutal wars by nuns and monks. Today in Germany, overlooking the Rhine, lies the Abbey of St. Hildegard. Named in memory of Hildegard of Bingen, who 9 centuries ago founded 2 cloisters here.
Ich habe seit meinem 18. Lebensjahr immer wieder mit dem Gedanken gespielt, ins Kloster zu gehen. Habe das aber immer wieder weggeschoben, habe immer gedacht, das ist eine jugendliche Naivität oder Träumerei. Habe dann erst studiert, Karriere gemacht, wie man das so schön sagt. Aber der Gedanke hat mich nicht losgelassen. Es war immer wieder, regelmäßig kam es auf, immer an entscheidenden Punkten meines Lebens. Und dann mit 33 Jahren habe ich gedacht, jetzt oder nie. Wenn du jetzt nicht es versuchst, dann bist du zu alt, dann schaffst du es nicht mehr. Und dann habe ich dieses Kloster kennengelernt auf einer Dienstreise. Und dann war es Liebe auf den ersten Blick. Stellung gekündigt, Wohnung verkauft, Auto verkauft, alles verschenkt, was ich hatte und bin hierher gekommen.
Today, religion in the Western world is a personal choice. But 900 years ago, choice was non-existent. Whoever you were in that distant time, whether peasant or prince, religion was as fundamental and real as gravity is for us today. The guide to this reality was the Bible. The past, present, and the future was measured by this text and its interpretation by church authorities. Hildegard of Bingen was born in 1098, 10th child of the nobles Mechtild and Hildebert. When Hildegard was 8, her parents placed her in a private religious setting to be educated. When she was 14, she entered a monastery where she became a nun and lived the quiet life expected of nuns, her days marked by prayer and work. Suddenly, in her 43rd year, something happened.
And the image I saw spoke. I, the highest blazing power, enkindle all sparks of life. I breathe forth nothing deadly. With my wings, I fly around the circle of the earth. I blaze above the beauty of the fields, shine in the waters, and burn in the sun, the moon, and the stars. I, the fiery power, remain hidden in all these things. They burn in me, for I am life.
It's interesting that although she had had visions by her own account since early childhood, she was very shy about them. When she was about 15, she realized that other people didn't see what she saw, and they thought she was acting weird and childish, so she got embarrassed and she became silent about her visions and remained silent about them throughout the whole of her early monastic life. Then in 1136, her mistress Jutta died, and Hildegard was elected as the new magistra, the new superior in her stead. Even so, she didn't begin to speak out.
But although I heard and saw these things, because of doubt and a low opinion of myself, I refused for a long time the call to write. Until, weighted down by the scourge of God, I fell ill. At last, compelled by many infirmities, with the witness of a certain noble girl of high morality, and the man whom I had secretly sought and found, I set my hand to writing.
At Hildegard's cloister of the Disibodenberg, there was both a men's section and a smaller women's section. The role of women of that time was limited. Most became wives and mothers, whose voices could only be heard in private. Some, if their families could afford it, entered a cloister. Throughout Europe, Latin was the universal language of knowledge. The cloister was the place where knowledge was kept and transmitted. But there was a difference. Women learnt enough Latin to sing the Psalms, while men were educated in the finer points of Latin grammar, which gave them access to the classic works in philosophy, music, mathematics, and medicine, and all other medieval fields of study. At the cloister, Hildegard was encouraged by her fellow nun, Ricardus von Stade, and the monk, Volmar, from the men's section of the cloister, whose formal training in Latin was needed in writing the visions down. With her friend's help, Hildegard began setting down in Latin her first major theological book, Scivias.
She felt, as it were, the rays of the sun penetrating her whole heart and her brain and her whole body, not burning her, but gently warming her. And in that illumination, she began to understand the scriptures, and she heard a voice saying to her, "Cry out and write."
Hildegard's dilemma was that though she was convinced it was God who had told her to write, as far as she knew, no woman had ever written before. She thought that the roles of man and woman had been created by God. If her visions as a woman were to be recognized, she knew she needed the support of the church authorities. She wrote directly to the most powerful abbot of that time, Bernard of Clairvaux.
"I have not dared to tell these things, since there are so many heresies abroad in the land. Good and gentle father, I have great anxiety about how much I should speak about what I have seen and heard. Please give me your opinion in this matter, because I am untaught and untrained in exterior material. But I'm only taught inwardly, in my spirit.
By sending a letter to the church authorities, telling about her visions, Hildegard was running a great risk. In that time, people thought to be heretics were driven out or killed. But despite this risk, she did speak out. Word of her writing began to work its way up through the church's strict hierarchical structure. The Disibodenberg abbot showed her writings to the Archbishop of Mainz. He was so impressed that he read them aloud to his clergy. When the official head of Christendom, Pope Eugenius III, held a synod at Trier, even the Pope was told a local nun seemed to be receiving visions directly from God.
Now, it helped that at this Synod of Trier, there were not only the cardinals and the bishops, but also Bernard of Clairvaux, who was a Cistercian abbot and the great celebrity saint of his age. Hildegard had written to him a few months earlier, and he wrote back to her at the time very briefly, but in a reassuring way, validating her and telling her to remain humble, but do as God instructed her to do. And when he heard the passages from the Scivias read at the Synod of Trier, he apparently spoke out publicly in her favor. And the Pope did a really extraordinary thing. He gave Hildegard a kind of papal seal of approval and told her to continue writing. After that, word spread very, very quickly that there was a new prophet in the land.
Hildegard wrote her visions directly onto wax tablets, and later these were written out on parchment, the permanent and expensive writing material of that age. Books written laboriously by hand and taking many months to complete were devoted to only the most important subjects. That the visions of a woman were preserved in book form was extremely unusual. What has been preserved of Hildegard's visions, despite many centuries of brutal wars, are some of the most beautiful volumes produced in over 1,000 years of monastic writing and book illustration.
I saw a form surrounded by fire. I saw a splendor, clear as crystal, around the image of a woman.
Now that Hildegard was famed as a prophet, people came to the tiny hilltop of the Disibodenberg, seeking counsel from the seer. Letters also started to come in, even from the greatest theological center at that time, Paris. Now, Hildegard was told in a vision that she must move to the Rupertsberg, a ruined cloister near the town of Bingen. But the Disibodenberg abbot did not want to lose the famous seer, and did not want her to take the possessions of her nuns with her.
Es war zu der Zeit üblich, wenn eine Frau in die Frauenklause eintrat, um dort zu leben, dass das Vermögen, das sie mitbrachte, dem Männerkloster zufiel. Und die Männer ihrerseits hatten dafür zu sorgen, dass die Frauen geschützt waren, und sie hatten auch die Seelsorge zu betreiben. Das Problem, der Weggang vom Disibodenberg, stand darin, dass dieser Weggang sich als finanzielles Problem für den Disibodenberg darstellte.
Hildegard knew that they needed to take with them the income from the nuns' dowries if they were to have their independence at the Rupertsberg. She spoke back to the abbot.
The gifts belong neither to you nor to your brothers, but if you want to grow stubborn in your opposition and gnash your teeth against us, here is the response of the divine. You are the worst thieves. God's judgment will destroy you. In these words, I demanded from the abbot the freedom of the place and the possessions of my daughters, and that these things be granted to me through a written contract in a legal codex. It is surely God's will that this be all pinned down in writing.
Even with Hildegard's strongest arguments, the abbot at first refused to let her go. Then she became so ill she could not move, and the abbot came to see her and tried to physically lift her up, but could not. That finally convinced him that it was God's will she be allowed to go.
Even before there were new buildings, apparently, they moved into the old, dilapidated buildings with no real foundation and no funds at the beginning. So in the first years, they had a rather difficult life. She had donors, especially her own family, giving properties in Bamersheim. But she also had other friends and relatives who donated properties and land.
In Hildegard's time, monasteries were an integral part of society, as abbeys held both spiritual and secular power. Abbeys held title to lands, and much of their income came from that land. In the great women's cloisters, women held powerful, largely independent positions that were recognized by secular and church authorities. At Hildegard's new cloister, one of her biggest supporters was the powerful family of her fellow nun, friend, and helper, Ricardus von Stade. But then, Ricardus was appointed abbess of one of the richest and most powerful women's cloisters of that day, and left the Rupertsberg.
Und Hildegard wehrt sich nun mit Händen und Füßen dagegen, dass Ricardus abwandert in das Bassumer-Kloster. Und sie schickt mehrere Briefe an ihre Vorgesetzten. Sie schickt einen Brief an die, an den Mainzer Erzbischof. Sie schickt einen Brief an den zuständigen Bremer Erzbischof, also an Hartwig von Bremen. Sie schickt auch einen Brief an die Mutter von Ricardus. Sie schickt sogar einen Brief bis Papst Eugen hoch, um mit aller Macht zu verhindern, dass nun dieser Wechsel vollzogen wird.
My spirit is exceedingly sad, because a certain horrible man has rashly dragged our beloved daughter Ricardus out of our cloister. If anyone, in his madness, willfully seeks to gain ecclesiastic office, that person is a rapacious wolf seeking the delights of power more than the will of God.
Was sie im tiefsten Inneren so sehr an Ricardus bindet, wissen wir nicht. Es gibt dann diesen sehr emotionalen, sehr ausdrucksstarken Brief nach dem Tode. Ricardus von Stade stirbt dann ja kurz nachdem sie ihr Amt angetreten hat. Aus dem Briefwechsel hat es den Anschein, dass sie im Grunde ihren Weggang nach Bassum bereut hat, dass sie gerne wieder zurückgekehrt wäre zum Rupertsberg, dass es ihr aber eben aus gesundheitlichen Gründen nicht mehr möglich war und dass sie dann nach kurzer Zeit gestorben ist. Und Hildegard schreibt dann nochmal nachträglich einen Brief an den Bruder Ricardus von Stades und sagt, dass ihre übergroße Liebe zu dem Unglück beigetragen habe.
Salvatore, Christus.
God favored her so greatly that worldly desire had no power to embrace her. For she always fought against it, even though she was like a flower in her beauty and loveliness in the symphony of the world. God loved her more. Therefore, he was unwilling to give his beloved to a heartless lover. That is, to the world.
Even after the death of her beloved Ricardis, life at the Rupertsberg was lived to the timeless rhythms of work and prayer, as practiced to this day at cloisters such as the St. Hildegard Abbey.
Das Opus Dei wurde im frühen Mönchtum nicht so sehr als ein als in, im Kurdienst gesehen, sondern das Opus Dei war das ganze Mönchsleben. Ora et labora, bete und arbeite. Und wer im Gehorsam arbeiten musste zu einer Kurzeit, das war gleichzeitig auch ein Gebet. Der Gehorsam, der Glaubensgehorsam des Arbeitenden war gleichzeitig auch Gebet. Ja? Und so hat Hildegard das auch verstanden.
As in the time of Hildegard, life is structured by praise being sung at regular intervals throughout the day. Within this strict and simple rhythm, Hildegard had the freedom to focus on the gratitude she felt to God. From her pen streamed a torrent of work, as she wrote three major theological books and composed over 70 songs, joyfully celebrating her vision of life.
You have a garden of people in which you seek to plant many wholesome desires and good works. God pours his dynamic goodwill upon those desires and those works, and causes the garden to grow green through the dew and the rain from the living fountain.
Hildegard had the everyday work of running the cloister she had established at the Rupertsberg. With her fame growing, she established another cloister on the opposite bank of the Rhine. These communities of sisters became known over a wide area for their beautiful singing.
Froh sein vor Gott und auch im Kloster froh sein. Kloster hat nichts zu tun mit irgendwelcher trübsinnigen ich würde sagen, mürrischen oder muffeligen, hat gar nichts damit zu tun. Das Problem liegt dann in mir selbst, verstehen Sie? Überhaupt war das Leben Hildegards ganz von der Freude geprägt. Und das erinnert mich an einen kleinen Ausspruch. Meine lieben Menschen, verlernen Sie das Tanzen nicht, sonst wissen die Engel im Himmel nichts mit Ihnen anzufangen.
Not everybody agreed with Hildegard's way of celebrating God.
Hildegard lässt ihre Nonnen nicht in schlichtem Gewand auftreten, sondern die dürfen sich schmücken. Die haben bunte Schleier, die haben Kronen, die sie sich aufsetzen, die entsprechend noch mit Edelsteinen und Kreuzen verziert sind. In der Zeit kam dann eine auch sehr empörte Anfrage eigentlich einer Äbtissin, die nun wissen wollte, wie bringt Hildegard das in Übereinstimmung mit der Anweisung von Paulus im Korintherbrief, dass Frauen einfach aufzutreten haben, dass sie sich nicht schminken, dass sie sich nicht hermachen sollen. Und Hildegard von Bingen antwortet auf eine sehr interessante Weise. Sie macht eine Unterscheidung. Sie unterscheidet die verheirateten Frauen und die Virgines. Die Nonnen ihres Klosters, die ja diese Virginis, diese Jungfrauen sind, haben eine besondere Rechtsstellung. Sie sind keinem Mann unterworfen, sie sind direkt Gott zugeordnet und von daher brauchen sie sich auch nicht an diese Paulus-Anweisungen zu halten. Von daher sind sie geradezu verpflichtet, sich als Bräute Gottes, als Bräute Jesu auch herauszuputzen und zu schmücken und entsprechend aufzutreten.
Amidst her communities of sisters, Hildegard developed her theology of women's role in the re-establishment of the harmony that existed before the devil entered the Garden of Eden.
Hildegard was deeply devoted to the Virgin Mary, and she wrote many, many songs in her honor. But instead of regarding Mary as simply the opposite of Eve, the good woman over against the bad woman, she saw Mary as a kind of recapitulation and recovery of Eve. For her, there's a great single feminine form that God has intended from the beginning for the nurturing and reproduction of the human race, so that Eve was designed to be the mother of all living. That's the name that Adam gave her, and Adam was right. Tragically, Eve went wrong, but Hildegard never represents Eve as the great author of evil. She sees her as led astray by Satan, who was envious of her capacity for motherhood. And so Mary came along and did right what Eve had done wrong, but she's the second Eve rather than the opposite of Eve. And so Mary becomes a figuration of the whole principle of the embodied God, God coming to be incarnate in the world, and that happened through Mary.
God brought forth the form of woman, which he made the mirror of all his beauty. O Mary, from your womb a new son has come forth, cleansing all the guilt of Eve. Mary, Savior, you bore the new light for humankind.
In Hildegard's theology, the Church is literally the mother who comforts, counsels, and heals. Every day, Hildegard's advice was sought, not only by the nuns at her own abbeys, but now, over a vast area, other cloisters asked for counsel and advice.
She would resolve squabbles. There would be one house where the abbot was a tyrant and the brothers were all up in arms against him. There would be another house where some scheming woman wanted to make herself abbess and was contested by the community, or another house where there was a very weak abbot or abbess that wanted to resign and was just pining out to go off to a little hermitage somewhere and have some peace. And Hildegard would talk to these communities. She would try to resolve the disputes. She would bear up the weak, need leadership and say, come on, do your job. God has given you this responsibility for a reason.
Part of her own job, as Hildegard saw it, was taking care of the health needs of her own nuns and of others needing medical help. In Hildegard's time, monasteries were the place people went for treatment when they were sick. It was nuns and monks who copied and studied ancient texts and also had knowledge of plants and their medical use. Cloisters had herb gardens and dispensaries where medicines were prepared. Hildegard gathered and wrote down the medical properties she observed of plants.
Fennel, eaten raw, will not harm a person. It makes people glad, giving them a mild glow and a pleasant smell. It makes for good digestion and eliminates bad breath and makes the eyes see clearly.
Not all of Hildegard's prescriptions can be used today. Much of the medicine of her time was based on superstitions and on information from classical writers that had been uncritically copied for many centuries. But Hildegard did not just copy. She observed plants and tried to find their effect on the human body.
Es waren einmal natürlich die Kräuter, die in der Umgebung des Klosters wuchsen. Man hat nachweisen können, dass die Flora des Nahegaus dort sehr gut vertreten ist, dass also die unmittelbare Kenntnis der Botanik der Umgebung mit eingeflossen ist. Es gibt aber natürlich auch, man findet auch Drogen, die eben nur auf dem Handelswege in diese Gebiete gekommen sein kann. Und jedem Einzelnen ist eine genaue Erklärung, eine rationale Erklärung zugefügt, warum diese Pflanze so wirkt.
Hildegard's method of first closely observing plants and then describing their effect on the human body was a step on the path from magic to science. But now her work would simply be copied for centuries to come, just like the classical writers were copied before her. Though much of her medical work is outdated, her view that physical and spiritual counsel are connected is timeless. And she is one of the first to describe women's bodies in positive terms, and men's and women's sexuality.
When a woman makes love with a man, a sense of heat in her brain brings sensual delight and communicates the taste of that delight during the act and calls forth the emission of the man's seed. And when the seed has fallen into place, the intense heat descending from her mind draws the seed and holds it. And soon the woman's sexual organs contract and all the parts that are ready to open up during the time of menstruation now close. In the same way a strong man holds something in his closed fist.
When Hildegard studied plants, nature, and human beings, she saw connections. And that any element, no matter how small or how large, had a purpose within a whole, seen by her as a gift from God.
It was customary to begin accounts of theology by talking about God as the supreme being or the one or supreme goodness. But that wasn't Hildegard's starting point. Her starting point was God is supreme life. God is just overflowing with vitality, and God is so much life that it is the divine that overflows, that gives life to all of creation.
The air moves the sea from which separate rivers flow to bind together the earth. Just as the interconnected veins strengthen a person's whole body with blood. And as the fruits of the earth are ripened in the air-like soul recognizes usefulness through thoughts, which flood like the sea.
fatue, fatue, quid protestibi laborare? Respice mundum.
For Hildegard, the constant threat to harmony was the devil. She wrote and composed the first known morality play, The Play of the Virtues. In Hildegard's play, a human soul is caught between the forces of good and evil. The devil in Hildegard's universe represents all that attempts to destroy the wholeness and harmony that was for her a gift from God. Evil, represented by the devil, is a central figure in her letters and books. Evil existed in the world, and therefore had to be fought with all means. By the end of the play, the human soul realizes that following the devil's temptation to take without giving leaves her unsatisfied. She, together with the virtue's combined strength, triumphs over the devil. Hildegard wrote a letter to Pope Anastasius.
Evil cannot make anything or do anything by itself because it is nothing but a false choice. Oh man, you who sit on the papal throne, you despise God when you embrace evil. For in failing to speak out against the evil of those in your company, you are certainly not rejecting it. Rather, you are kissing it. And so, the whole world is being led astray.
For Hildegard, God had given everyone, including the Pope, a specific job to do in the world. Knights should fight, farmers should farm, and clergy should preach instead of buying and selling church offices or appointing relatives to church positions, gathering material wealth and secular power. This, she thundered, was to do the devil's work.
You should be mighty winds teaching all the people, but you were worn out by seeking after your own reputation in the world. So at one point you are knights, the next moment slaves, the next mere court jesters. When you perform your duties in a half-hearted manner, the best you are doing is brushing off flies in the summer.
What she was saying was highly critical of the church leadership, and it was really extraordinary that she was allowed to do this. And clearly the only reason she was allowed to do it was that people believed that God was actually speaking through her, and she would speak in the first person for God. That's what it meant to be a prophet, to say, "Thus says the Lord," as the prophets do in the Bible. And she would prophesy the future, she would denounce abuses, she would really chastise the clergy for being lazy about preaching, because in her view, it was their laziness, their lack of willingness to preach, that allowed heresy to spread.
After centuries of attacks, from the north, the Vikings, from the east, the Magyars, Europe was no longer being attacked from outside. The violent invaders had been Christianized. But though Europe was supposedly unified under Christianity, knights everywhere now fought one another. And on the larger scale, final authority was militarily disputed between Pope and Emperor. The Pope argued that as God's representative, he should have power to crown the Emperor. And the Emperor argued he had the authority to choose the Pope. Hildegard, with her authority as prophet, endorsed by the Pope, and a charter of protection granted by the Emperor Barbarossa, had to constantly deal with both warring parties.
She was, after all, an imperial German abbess. She had a charter of protection from Barbarossa. She came from the aristocracy, and simply by belonging to that milieu of privilege, she had a certain degree of social protection and access to power that the abbesses of a later era, with their vastly reduced authority, could not have commanded.
Many cloisters all along the Rhine that had chosen the Pope's side against the Emperor had been destroyed by Barbarossa. Even with the Emperor's troops stationed at his palace in Ingelheim, less than a day's march from her cloisters, Hildegard directly challenged the Emperor when he appointed his own candidate as Pope.
O King, guard yourself so that the King of Heaven does not strike you down in your blindness. He who is says, I destroy those who oppose me or who do not value me highly enough. Remember that, O King, if you desire to continue to live. Otherwise, my sword will go right through you.
For whatever reason, the Emperor did not attack Hildegard's cloisters. Hildegard's insistence that temporal rulers not interfere with the church was an idea ahead of its time. She was an early and outspoken advocate of church reform, anticipating Martin Luther by several centuries.
Hildegard did make several preaching tours. This was absolutely exceptional, if not unprecedented for a woman. She didn't do so until quite late in her life, starting when she was already in her 60s and continuing well into her 70s. So she would have been an old, venerable woman already in broken health. Her health had never been good, so she must have been quite a formidable personage.
The word is in the voice, and the word is heard. And the fire has a flame, and is praise to God. And the wind moves the flame, and is praise to God. And the word is in the voice, and is praise to God. And the word is heard, and is praise to God.
For Hildegard, her music was part of a whole, as is her writing, her medicine, her religion, and her worldview. For her, the individual human being was the center, mirroring and embodying all of God's creation. Music was the highest form of expression. It was the ultimate praise to human beings, to life, and to God. When Hildegard had reached her 80th year and was ill and physically weak, she suddenly found herself involved in a desperate battle, this time with her church superiors. At her abbey, a nobleman had been buried. He had once been excommunicated by the church, but had sought and been granted forgiveness before he died. Suddenly, she got an order from her church superiors in Mainz that the nobleman must be dug up at once, because they claimed he had not been forgiven and could not remain in holy ground. Hildegard refused and hid all traces of the disputed grave.
We have not presumed to remove the body of the deceased nobleman because he had confessed his sins and had received last rites and Holy Communion.
The church superiors immediately punished the cloister in the most serious way. They forbade the cloister to practice what was central to their lives, singing God's praises. And they refused to allow the nuns to receive the sacraments, which meant to them they would go to hell if they should die.
You and all clergy must clear the air with full and thorough discussion before your verdict closes the mouth of any church singing praises to God. You must be certain that you do this out of zeal for God's justice rather than out of indignation or a desire for revenge. You must be on your guard against Satan, who drove man from celestial harmony and the delights of paradise.
Though Hildegard disagreed, she obeyed the order not to sing. But she wrote to her archbishop, who was away in Rome, and he finally wrote back, admitting that her burial of the nobleman had been correct and his subordinates in Mainz had been wrong. "We grant you the privilege," the archbishop wrote, "of celebrating the divine office." And the singing at her cloister was heard again. Six months after the victory over the clergy of Mainz, in her 82nd year, Hildegard of Bingen died. After her death, Hildegard's nuns and many other supporters wanted her to be declared a saint by the Pope. But the clergy in Mainz did not send the proper material to Rome, so this could not happen. This was symbolic of centuries to come, where the power of cloisters would be diminished and where learning would shift to universities, places that excluded women for over 700 years. Women were told to be silent and not speak in public. Many who did speak out or practiced healing would be burned at the stake. It is because a handful of people for hundreds of years preserved Hildegard of Bingen's manuscripts, music, letters, and songs that they are available to us today.
Kinds of melodies have been invented for the delight of the soul, recalling that in Adam's voice before the fall there was the sound of every harmony. Often, when hearing some melody, we recall the nature of heavenly harmony.